Section 1 of Harper's Young People, Volume 1, Issue 28, May 11, 1880. Harper's Young People, Volume 1, Issue 28, May 11, 1880. Why? Hunting in Arctic Regions. The Story of George Washington, Chapter 5. Why? Why must I learn to sing? Why learn to fly? Said a young bird to its mother. Why, oh why? All birdies learn to sing, all learn to fly, to the young bird said its mother. And that's why. Hunting in Arctic Regions. Although in the remote and dreary ice regions of the extreme north, a variety of game, including bear, whale, walrus, seal, reindeer, foxes, wolves, ptarmigan, ducks, and geese, is found and pursued by the hardy Eskimo, or Inuit, it is upon the capture of the seal that he expends the most time and labor. The seal is everything to him, and without it life could hardly be sustained. In the words of Captain Hall, to the Inuit, the seal is all that flocks and herds, grain fields, forests, coal mines, and petroleum wells are to dwellers in more favored lands. It furnishes him with food, fuel, and clothing. Nutchuk, the seal, is one of the most wary and suspicious of animals, and to capture him when he is on his guard requires an almost incredible amount of skill and perseverance. The Inuit say that Ninu, the bear, taught them to capture the seal, and that if they could talk to Nutchuk as cleverly as Ninu does, they would capture him much oftener than they do. When Ninu sees at a distance upon the ice a black spot that he knows to be a Nutchuk taking a nap beside his air-hole, he makes up his mind that he will dine that day off seal. Nutchuk's nap is a series of cat-naps, each lasting about 10 seconds, and after each he lifts his head and looks around. Ninu crouches low upon the ice, and creeps along when the seal is napping. The moment his head is raised, the bear stops short and begins to talk to Nutchuk. The sound that he utters while thus talking is quite different from his ordinary voice, and seems to charm the seal, who lays his head down for another nap, during which Ninu again advances. At last the bear is within springing distance, and in a moment all is over with poor Nutchuk. Although seals are caught at all the seasons of the year, the great hunt takes place in the spring and early summer months. At this time the fur is in the best possible condition, and as they play in the open water lanes near the coast, or bask in great numbers on the ice, their capture is comparatively easy. During the summer, the glare of the sun so affects the eyes of the seal that he becomes almost blind and is easily approached. Hundreds of vessels, many of them steamers, are engaged in the seal fishery, and on the first page of this number is a picture of the boats belonging to one of these sealers drifting cautiously down upon a number of seals that have been basking and frolicking on the ice, heedless of the approach of danger. Hundreds of thousands of seals are thus killed every year for the sake of their skins, which are shipped to every part of the world, and from which are made the beautiful sacks, muffs, tippets, and gloves with which most of our readers are so familiar. Only last month a disaster occurred that vividly illustrates the danger of sealing. A huge ice field, 100 miles long, and bringing with it thousands of seals, drifted down from the north and stranded on the coast of Newfoundland, near St. John's. For several days the people living along the coast ventured far out on the ice and captured great numbers of the seals. Suddenly, on the 4th of April, the northeast wind that had been blowing steadily for 2 weeks and keeping the ice packed changed to a warm southerly breeze. The ice pack broke, became intersected in every direction by lanes of water, and began to drift out to sea, carrying with it more than 200 of the hardy hunters. Many of these were rescued by steamers, but others were borne away into the fog, beyond the hope of rescue, far out to sea, where they have perished from starvation, freezing, or drowning. For weeks past, dead bodies have been cast upon the rugged coast by the sea, but the fate of many of the lost will never be known. Mr. Ninu, who hunts the seal so successfully, is hunted in turn for the sake of his thick, soft fur, and often falls victim both to white men and Eskimo. The latter sometimes kills him by rolling a thick piece of whalebone about 2 feet long and 4 inches wide into a small coil and wrapping it in a piece of seal blubber so that it forms a ball. Placed outside the hut, it soon freezes hard. Provided with this frozen bait, the natives search for Ninu. When they find him, they run away, and he chases them. But they drop the ball of blubber, and he, meeting with it, greedily swallows it whole. In a few minutes, the heat of his body thaws the blubber and releases the whalebone. It uncoils with terrible force, and so tears his stomach that the great bear falls down in helpless agony, to which an end is quickly put by the hunter, who now hurries to the spot. Begun in Harper's Young People, number 24, April 13. The Story of George Washington by Edward Carey. Chapter 5. So now the war was as good as finished. There was no more fighting. The British government was nearly ready to give up to the United States, and own that they were and of right ought to be free and independent, as the great Declaration had said more than 5 years before. But such things take a long time to settle, and General Washington thought that the Americans could make a great deal better terms of peace if they kept ready for war. How tired he was of the war! How he longed to get back to Mount Vernon and to his peaceful farmer's life! His letters written about this time are full of these desires. He was a great general, but the whole country honored and loved him as a man whose courage and skill had made his countrymen free. But he often said that he would give up all the glory he had won if he could go back to his crops and his trees, his horses and his hounds, and his beloved family in rest. Yet he stood by his post to the very last. He begged his countrymen to keep up the army and not to lay down their arms till everything was sure. He begged his officers and soldiers to be patient and stay with him, though they had much reason to complain. They had been poorly paid, or not paid at all. Many of them were actually ruined for the country, and when they left the army, did not know where or how they should get a living. At this moment some of them thought they would be happier and better off under a king, if that king were Washington. They said to themselves, "It is all very well to be free, but here is a free nation which turns its old soldiers out to starve, which does not pay its debts, which hardly deserves freedom. We should have greater justice and more peace and safety with this wise, strong man as king." One of Washington's officers hinted as much to him. The general was filled with sorrow and anger and shame at the very thought. What had he done that men should think he would consent to such treason? He wrote to the man who had suggested the plan, "If you have any regard for your country, or respect for me, banish these thoughts from your mind." At last, in the spring of 1783, word came that a treaty of peace had been signed, and that the independence of the United States was no longer disputed. This joyful news was read to the American army on the 19th of April, just 8 years after the first gallant fight at Concord in 1775. Washington wrote a farewell address to the army which he had led so long. It was like the wise and loving speech of a good father. He thanked them warmly for the noble spirit with which they had upheld him during the tedious and cruel years of war. He reminded them of the end for which they had fought, that the United States might be a free nation, with the right to govern itself as it thought best. And he prayed them to do all that they could to make their country just and wise in peace, as it had been brave and fortunate in war. It was winter before Washington had the affairs of his command settled so that he could leave the army and return to his home. On the 4th of December, he met the principal officers of the army at New York to bid them farewell. They were gathered for that purpose at Francis Tavern when he entered. Filling a glass, he turned to them and said, "With a heart full of love and gratitude, I now take leave of you. I most devoutly wish that your latter days may be as prosperous and happy as your former ones have been, glorious and honorable." Then, one by one, as the officers came to him, he clasped hands with each and embraced him in silence. These brave men, who had faced death together, and had cheerfully borne untold privation, were not ashamed to weep at parting with their beloved friend and chief. When he had saluted them all, he passed through a corps of soldiers outside the door, and walked to the riverside, followed by the officers in solemn silence. He entered the barge, and raising his hat, he waved them farewell, and they, with the same loving gesture, watched the barge push off and turned away. Washington took his journey to Annapolis in Maryland, gave up his commission to Congress, and returned to Mount Vernon. He reached his home on Christmas Eve, 1783. It was more than 8 years and a half since he had left it to join the Continental Congress at Philadelphia, and he had seen it but twice in that long interval. When he went away, he was 43 years old, in the very prime of manhood. When he returned, he was 51, and felt that he was growing old. Constant labor, constant care, exposure in the camp and on the march, and the sad and fearful experience of battle had told upon his naturally strong frame, and he welcomed the prospect of rest as simply and as gladly as a tired child. He wrote to his dear friend Lafayette, who had returned to...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.